That is it correct or is it wrong?
My question is that how a woman can be forced to be married with a Muslim?
The brother asked the question that when you have a war, and in the war when you take the spoils of war, and even in what your right hand possesses, you are allowed, that in Islam, you are allowed to have relationship with your wife and that which your right hand possesses. At that time it was very common, you know, like how we today also we have in the Western world, you know, having girlfriends is very common, having mistresses is common. In Islam, when you have relationship, you can only have with your wife and that which your right hand possesses. Now, when you have a war, whatever you booty you get, it becomes part of you. And what we have prisoners of war, how we have prisoners of war, you know, POW.
Okay.
POW. Okay. Today we say slave. In Islam, they are called as prisoners of war normally in technical terms. Now, compared to prisoners of war of today and what Islam says, there's a world of a difference. The rights and the honor and the treatment what the slave get in Islam is far superior to POW. Even if you read the UN Charter, what happens in Guantanamo Bay, you know?
No, I don't know.
Guantanamo Bay, you don't know? No. Guantanamo Bay, have you heard of Guantanamo Bay?
I never heard about that.
Guantanamo Bay, where, you know, the Americans, they put prisoners which are Muslims.
Yeah, allegation. Guantanamo Bay.
Yes, okay. Guantanamo Bay.
Okay.
You know, so
yes,
if you
I
know.
Heard about that. But the position of, sorry to interrupt.
Yes, I'm just coming to it. In comparison to prisoners of war, in prisoners of war today, when you catch a prisoner, he's enslaved in a jail, correct?
Yes.
Or there may be a camp, he cannot go out.
Okay.
In Islam, our prisoners of war, they are free. They are free, but they should not run away. They are not enchained. You can use them. You can take work from them. But as compared to prisoners of war in the modern world, where there is no freedom, they are kept in that jail or in that camp. They aren't allowed to go out. Compared to vis-a-vis, what happens in an Islamic war when it takes place? And that time when you have prisoners of war, they have got some restriction, but they are treated much better than as compared to kept in the jails.
Okay.
So if you compare this,
okay,
it is far
this.
More superior.
So there is no force in this situation, am I right?
No, there's no force.
Okay. Let's go to the other part of the question. Then what is the jizya?
Jizya. As far as second question is concerned, jizya is a tax imposed on the non-Muslims living in a Muslim state for their protection. For example,
one question between of this.
Wait, you pose the question, let me give the answer.
Okay.
I haven't completed the answer, you want to ask the next question. Let me complete the answer and then you can ask.
Okay, I know the way you wish you are talking with the people in your YouTube.
No, which, so if you know the way you're asking.
just I remind you that I know that.
So I'm just completing. So if you have asked the question, I have to complete the question.
Okay,
I don't know which YouTube is off mine. The correct, authentic one or the adulterated one?
Most of them I already reviewed and I am thankful for whatever you replied about them.
You know, mashallah, many people, they are using my photograph to propagate wrong things. You know?
No, I used your photo last around.
No, not you. What? Other people, I'm telling you.
Okay. I just remind you that I said to my people that you are going.
So as long as jizya is concerned, it's a tax imposed on non-Muslims living in Islamic State for their protection. Today, in most of the countries, if there is a war, you have to go and fight. You have no option. In an Islamic state, in the Khilafat, every Muslim, if the Khalifa says, he has to go and fight. He has no option. He cannot say, I'm rich. He cannot say, I'm a doctor. He has to go and fight. But for a non-Muslim, he need not go and fight. He's protected. And for this protection, he is paying a small amount. I'm asking you a question. If you're living in a country, whether it be India or any country, and they say pay just a few hundred rupees or maybe pay a few dollars and you're protected, is that better or you should go on the war field? Which is better?
I will prefer to pay you.
So jizya tax is a small amount.
So, but the point...
And this amount is just to agree, okay, fine, we agree that you're the protectors and you'll be protected, you need not go for the war. But the Muslim has no choice. Muslim cannot say, I will pay jizya, I don't want to go for the war. He has to go. He has no option. If the Khalifa says he has to go, he has to go. for the non-Muslim is protected, so it's more secured. If I'm in your position, I would prefer paying some money and staying at home secured rather than going in the battlefield. Yes, brother, next question.
Okay. It's the same question, actually. I understand for the protection we have to pay tax or whatever you name it. But according to my understanding, Jizya is three sections. You either should pay or fight or become Muslim. According to my understanding, means a country like Iran is next to us and they are not Muslims. We should fight with them or they have to pay or they become Muslim. Is that right?
No. When a Muslim takes over or conquers any land, if they become a Muslim, then they have no option. They can't pay jizya. If required, they have to fight in the battlefield. No option. So if you become a Muslim...
So in this case, they are forced to pay.
Not forced. If they become a Muslim, they have no option of jizya. They have to fight when required. If you don't want to accept Islam, then you pay a nominal tax saying that we agree that you are our protectors. This is the fee. That's it.
Okay. The question is that like a country like Spain, which is called in Islamic history as Andalus, how Islam spread till that location, it was with force or without force?
Today, if you see the history of the world and the history of Islam, today, yes, there were battles fought. But today, the media portrays as though Islam was spread by the sword.
Yeah.
And the reply to this is given very well by Dilisi Oleri in his book, Islam at the Crossroads, on page number 8. He says that history makes it clear that the legend of fanatical Muslims sweeping across the world, forcing Islam at the point of the sword, is the most fantastic, absurd myth that historians ever repeated. It is a myth. Yeah, there have wars been taking place.
Just give me a sign that I can start my question.
This is a question answer session, not a discussion session, brother.
Okay.
He will go up till morning. Ask the question one. You non-Muslim, I gave you 2 chants, 3 chants, 4 chants, the other people waiting.
I am agnostic actually. I am thinking, I am reading. I am studying.
Agnostic is also a non-Muslim only.
Yeah.
Even agnostic is a non-Muslim.
Okay.
Inshallah, we pray to Allah to make you a theist, a believer in God, inshallah.
I believe in God. I have no problem about the God.
If you're agnostic, you cannot believe in God.
Actually,
that means your English language is a big weak, brother. Agnostic is a person who doesn't say there is God and doesn't say there is no God. He's silent. If you say you believe in God, you become a theist. Agnostic means a person who doesn't believe there is God and doesn't believe there is no God. He's silent.
Okay.
So actually you are a theist.
Yes.
You believe in God.
In this case you can call me
okay,
like
okay, so coming back to what I said earlier.
Yeah.
So you're keeping interrupting into the whole thing. The answer is going here and there.
No. Sorry for that.
So
I'm listening to you carefully.
So in this, for as long as spread of Islam is concerned today, the country... If you know, the Dilisi Oleri said, it's a myth that Islam was spread by the sword. Yes, there are wars been taking place. There are. But that's not the major spread. Today, do you know, in the Arab land, there are about 8 to 9 million Arabs who are Coptic Christians. Who are Christians since generation. You know, we Muslims, the Arabs, they ruled the Arab land for 1400 years. For a few years the French came, for the few years the Britishers came. Overall, we have been the Lord. If we wanted, we could have forced every Arab to accept Islam at the point of the sword. These today, 9 million Arab Christians, they are bearing witness that Islam was inspired by the sword. We Indians, you know, the Muslims ruled India for 1,000 years. If we wanted, we could have forced every Indian to accept Islam at the point of the sword. We did not do it. Today, more than 75% of Indians, they are non-Muslims. These 75% non-Muslim Indians, they are giving shahada. They are bearing witness that Islam was inspired by the sword. Today, the country which has the largest number of Muslims, it's Indonesia. Which Muslim army went to Indonesia? Which Muslim army went to Malaysia, which has 55% Muslims? Which Muslim army went to the east coast of Africa? Senegal, Gambia. They are Muslims. Which Muslim army went there? It is the sword of intellect. So if you see the history of Islam, the spread, the major was by people because of the deeds, because of the actions, because of business. So today, Islam has spread because of its values, not because of the sword. It's a misconception. Hope that answers the question. I'd like to ask you a question, brother.
Yes.
Where do you come from?
Originally from Iran.
From Iran?
Yes.
You're originally from Iran?
Yes.
And you say that you're agnostic, now you said you believe in God.
I am believing in God, truly, but I am studying from the bottom of heart, what is the word, what is the kainat, whatever. I want to truly believe what I am believing.
I would request you to watch my video cassette, Is the Quran God's Word? You may have seen many of my videos.
This one I didn't see.
So surely go on the YouTube, Zakir Naik channel.
Yes.
It's in HD, mashallah.
Yes, you're in my favorite list also.
Mashallah, you're one of the subscribers.
Yes.
Good. You know, the YouTube gave an award to us. The vice president of YouTube said, Dr. Zakir is awesome. So maybe because of your subscription also, mashallah, I got the award. So jazakallah. So I request you. So
I want to be, let me clearly say that after a long study in my life, 30 years old I am, you are the most rational person I have seen in my life. That's why I came here. And this question is from the bottom of my heart. I want to be clear. And if I am a Mormon, I want to be a clear Mormon. I don't want to be like half Mormon, half not Mormon.
So brother, what is stopping you from accepting Allah? Do you believe in Allah?
Yes.
You believe that He's the most powerful?
Yes.
He's the only one should be worshipped?
Yes. This is
then no one else besides Allah?
Yes.
Allah, that's the main pillar. Second thing, do you believe that Prophet Muhammad is the messenger of Allah?
I have problem about these things. That's why I'm...
What's your problem? What is your problem? I can help you, brother.
Actually, the history which is behind Islam...
Sorry?
The history which is behind Islam, when we read it, we see something unfair between that. And not unjust. I mean, I cannot feel it is logical. That's why I am studying.
Brother,
to
when
find
you study history is not the right thing to study. I say study Quran.
Like the way which you said, I am referring to Quran about Jizya. In ayah about, I think, 29 Surah Tawbah mentioned, they have, it is about Allah, Allazina, it is about Ahl al-Kitab. It's not about non-Muslim, it's about Ahl al-Kitab that have to pay Jizya.
Ahl al-Kitab is also non-Muslim, brother. Ahli Kitab are non-Muslim. They're Christians and Jews. They're non-Muslims. So they have to pay jizya.
Okay.
Same thing. This, protection with the small money.
It is qatilul ladhina. Yani fight, even killed. That much going behind
there. When you say about Surah Tawbah, this fighting is talking in the battlefield. Many of the people quote out of context. In the battlefield, you have to fight. You cannot sleep.
Okay, how I accept that.
And again, people quote out of context. This is a context when people come to kill you.
So the people in Andalus was trying to kill Muslims.
Forget Andalus. I'm not bothered about Andalus. I'm not bothered about India. I'm bothered about Quran and the Sahih Hadith. If people in Andalus did some mistake, why should I be responsible?
How Muslims go to Andalus?
I am not here to talk about Andalus or talk about Mughals. I'm here to talk about Quran, Allah and His Messenger Muhammad. Khalas.
Okay.
History, if there is a bad Muslim, just because the Muslim is a bad example, why are you blaming Islam for that? See, for example,
okay,
you want to judge a car, a latest Mercedes car, S500 in the market.
Okay.
Latest 2016 model. Fine?
Yeah.
You want to judge how good the car is. If a person who does not know how to drive the car and bangs up the car, who will you blame, the car or the driver?
Of course, driver.
Driver! Yeah. So look at the car! Yeah. The car! Yeah, this is the car.
I am referring to Quran for of my study.
But Spain, forget about Spain, you are talking Andalus. Okay. There is no Andalus in the Quran.
Yes.
Huh?
Okay, I will read about it, I will think
that
about
that's the reason, forget about history. It is good for knowledge.
Okay.
But number one is read the Quran and the Sahih Hadith. And accept it, inshallah. I pray to Allah to give you hidayah, inshallah.
Thank you so much.
Welcome back, friends. I hope you enjoy the video till the last minute. The brother asked a very important and a very good question, that why Islam forcefully married to a woman when they make the slave after the war with the non-Muslims. So my dear brother and sister, Islam is the religion of peace, and always it will be a religion of peace, because Islam says that الرجال قوامون على النساء. And in another verse, Almighty Allah clearly says that وقتل المشركين حيث وجدتموهم. Actually, when the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam began the advertisement of Islam, and whenever the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that I am the final prophet, and oh people, you should say la ilaha illallah, you will be successful. So most of the people, they were against the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, especially the uncle of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Abu Talib. He was completely against on the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he said that, "O Prophet, O Muhammad, you are just invite us just for this bullshit news." And then he says some bad words. That's why Almighty Allah revealed the words, a complete verse in the Holy Quran on Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that "Tabbat yada Abi Lahab wa tab ma aghna anhu maluhu wa ma kasab." And sayasla naran zata lahab. So my dear brother and sister, when the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam start the Islam conversation and trying to convert the people from fake religion into the original religion of Islam, most of the people were against him. At time by time, these people, non-Muslim people, they create different kind of destruction with the Muslims, with the battles of Muslim, and also with the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But at that time, the number of Muslim were so less in number, even they are in a countable number. And the number of enemies of Islam, they were in thousands, millions of number in number. So that's why Almighty Allah doesn't give him the permission to do battle with the non-Muslim. That's why at that time, when the non-Muslim, they attack on Muslim, so Muslim were completely disbalanced, because they were less in number, they have no weapons, also they have not enough food to survive themselves. So that's why they were skipping, the people of Islam, they were skipping by time to time. When the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam make hijrah, when the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam migrate from Mecca to Medina, so from there rise of Islam has been started. Because in Medina there were non-Muslim, yes, there were some Jews, and there were Jews, and also there were some people who were Muslim before the migration of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So when the Muslims went to Medina, so then the Islam has been started step by step, and in the number of Muslims they were increasing day by day. So by then the first war between Muslim and the non-Muslim that what happened at Badr, that is called Ghazwe-Badr. In Ghazwe-Badr there were 313 companions of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that they start the fighting, and the number of enemies of Islam that were 1,000. It means that 3x, 2x, double than the number of Muslim. But Almighty Allah sent his angels in the war, and that's why the Muslims win the battle, and then they kill the 70s of the 70 enemies of Islam, and also they arrested the 70 people. So this is the, we can say that this is the institution of Islam, that whenever you have a war with non-Muslim, when you conquer the country, when you conquer these Muslim countries, so the women are your slaves. If they are Muslims, so then nothing have to do. But if they are non-Muslim, then you will be make slave of them, and then it is your wish that whatever you want to do with your slave, it is okay. If you want a relationship with the woman that is your slave, so then it's okay. So Islam doesn't say that it is injustice. Why these women of non-Muslim, why they are doing better with the Muslims when they are not capable to survive? So my dear brother and sister, there are on many occasions when Muslims battle with the non-Muslims, so they conquer the non-Muslim countries, and their women and their daughters, they were the slaves of the Muslim. Later on, these slaves were accepted Islam, and they were free by the, they are free by the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and his companion. But if you look at the history of European countries and Western American countries, what are they doing with the Muslim communities, with the Muslim women. We are look at the Dr. Afia Siddiqui. What happened to him and why she is still in American cage? What happening to his body? Anybody can do it. So my dear brother and sister, these Western countries, these are the real terrorist people. Why? That's why they are chasing Islam in from different side to side, and from every angle they are showing to the country that Muslims are the terrorist country like that. But my dear brother and sister, Islam is the religion of peace. If you have any doubt, you should research it properly through the YouTube, through the Google, and through many parts of the globe. I hope you enjoy the video. If you like the video, subscribe the channel and share it with your friends.